and welcome to Joy in Our Town. I'm your host, Vanessa Rose. Thank you so much for tuning in to join us for another great edition. Today we are speaking about civic affairs, and we are joined by one of our very own council members from here in the city of Phoenix, Councilman Jim Waring from District 2.
Vanessa, thanks so much for having me on.
I really appreciate it. So nice to have you, Councilman Waring. Thank you for being here. I want you to tell a little bit about yourself, but first, you represent District 2. Why don't you tell us what area you're representing here in the city of Phoenix?
It's basically the Paradise Valley border, which is roughly Shea, going north along Scottsdale Road, along the Scottsdale border, up to Carefree Highway. So it cuts across where Cave Creek and Carefree start, goes across to I-17, and then comes back down I-17.
Wow, and that reminds us how big the city of Phoenix really is, huh?
Well, our districts, each council member's district is roughly 200,000 people, which I'm told would make each district the sixth biggest city in Arizona.
Wow.
So each district is pretty large. I used to serve in the state senate, and it's about the same size as a state senate district.
Okay.
So it's a big area.
It is. Wonderful. Well, before we get started with the topics here, if you wouldn't mind just sharing a little bit about yourself and how you got to be a city council member.
Sure. I will not go too long. I don't want your viewers to turn off as they
get bored hearing
my life story. But real quickly, I'm from Illinois. Grew up, my parents were teachers, grew up in Illinois, had an interest in public service, moved out here to go to graduate school in 1991, finished my PhD at ASU, was working for the universities, volunteering. I was Republican, so volunteering on Young Republicans in different campaigns, and I just got interested myself, ran for the state Senate, and won kind of an upset victory in 2002 and served there. Was out of office, and Bill Gates, who was on the city council, convinced me that I should run for the city council. There was an appointment coming down, and so I think we're going to talk about that in a little bit. But the council person in our area resigned to run for mayor. That set off an appointment process, so somebody was appointed, and a really nice fella, but it was thought that maybe I'd represent the district a little better, a little more in concert with, I think, what people were looking for up there. And so I ran the race and I won, and I'm really enjoying it. It's been an excellent experience, and I do think we're making a big difference on the council.
Do you like being in city council versus you came from a state position? Mm-hmm. What's kind of briefly the difference there in working in city?
You know, it's funny,
state?
That is the most asked question. I get that all the time, the newspapers asked. One big difference is staffing. Not necessarily even for better or worse, but at the state senate, the staffers report to us. It's more like a private sector experience. At the city, we hire a city manager. We're more like a board of directors for a corporation. And so the nine of us, you have to have a majority of the nine, so five of us basically pool together and decide who the city manager is gonna be. It can be more than five, but the majority has to decide, this is our city manager. And then the city manager is the person who hires all the employees. We have about 14,500 employees, including people, folks here of like the police chief, the fire chief, et cetera. And so it's a big deal. Our budget's about $1.3 billion. And then we also own the airport and the water department, and those are about $1 billion each as well. So while we control the decision-making and the policies, we don't hire the people. So my answer to this is always, at the state, even though there was more state, 90 state legislators, plus a lot of time I was at the state Senate, there was a Democrat governor. So it wasn't like we were in complete control, but you definitely had an expectation of what you were gonna get. At the city, it's really more, they'll take your advice, but you're not just gonna be able to decide. And that can be frustrating for elected officials because we're the people who run and put our names on the signs and so forth. But that is one big difference. Get along with the staffers fine, but I do have to explain to constituents, just because there's a pothole, I can ask them politely to fix it, but I can't order them to go out and do it. And if for some reason, and this has never happened, but if there were some issue and they absolutely just adamantly refused to do something, I really can't even criticize them. That is in the city charter. This came up last, maybe a year and a half ago now, with the police chief. There was a police chief issue. He wound up getting fired, but that's for the city manager to do, not us. I'd love to see that changed, frankly.
Yeah.
But it's not likely to change anytime soon. It would be something that voters would have to see on the ballot.
So it's something, it almost sounds like, in a way, it could become a bit of a checks and balance, so that way that the elected officials don't have too much power over.
I think that's exactly.
Yeah.
I think that's exactly what was desired. I do think, though, that also has consequences because you don't get quite the immediate reaction when constituents call my office. Again, unless I'm going to go fill the pothole myself.
Exactly.
We don't have an asphalt account in our office budget.
You know,
it's one of those things where, you know, I have to go again, sort of politely ask, sometimes maybe not even so politely, but it is it can be a source of frustration. And another thing that's different is that the legislature, we did have a Democrat governor for most of my time. Governor Brewer came in for the last year, but we did have, you know, control of both legislative bodies. So your bills had a pretty good chance of getting through, mm-hmm. and so forth. I serve in the solid minority at the city council. There are only three of us who are Republicans now, Sal DiCicco and Velda Williams and myself. And so, you know, the other six are Democrats and sometimes vote accordingly. So while we agree on some things and are trying to move the city forward, a lot of things like the budget, which I think we'll also probably wind up talking about.
Yes.
You know, it's not, we're not always on the winning side, which can be frustrating.
Yes.
But it also gives us a chance to make our arguments. And I found when you have really logical arguments, it's really hard for the other side to push back. So that's a good challenge, and we're enjoying the service very much.
That is. That's very interesting to hear, because I think a lot of people assume a city councilman, they can call your office and make a request. But I think it's good for people to understand that there's tiers that are built in there, so you just can't make a phone call and make something happen. You actually have to go through a whole line of...
And we can help, and
yes,
they should and call.
And you can help.
And if they've called a city department to fix a water leak or something, please call us too. If
so
not me,
your,
then call the mayor's
okay.
office. Call if I'm not your councilman. You can still call me, but
yeah.
also call your councilman or woman. I think that's important, and it certainly can make the employees focus more on getting the task done.
Okay.
But if there's a water leak that's been going for a couple weeks and this kind of thing does happen, you know, please let us know as well. If you feel like you're not getting the service you're demanding, please let us know. Our role is a little akin to an ombudsman, mm-hmm. in that we sort of, as you talked about the checks and balances, we sort of are a check of, hey, ultimately, I can call, and I do, call the city manager and say, hey, you know, I'm not casting aspersions, I'm simply saying, there's a water leak, and it's been a couple weeks, and it hasn't been fixed. Somebody needs to do something about it. And then that is their direct supervisor.
Oh, okay.
You know, that person, want to do what the city manager requests. So we have a lot of those instances. One that comes up a lot is I want a stop sign on my street, which is a meritorious request in a lot of cases. Unfortunately, I can't order the stop sign to be put in, and the traffic, there are international traffic rules and
yes.
regulations, and so our traffic guys, sensibly enough, won't violate them. Sometimes a traffic signal apparently can actually make things more hazardous rather than less. And so learn more about traffic and streets than I would have expected in this job. But it's been fascinating, because I would have expected, as you suggested,
yeah.
if I would have called when I was a private citizen, that something like that would just be done. The public servant would want to make me happy, I'm a voter. And that isn't necessarily the way it works. And to your point, maybe that's not the way it should work.
Yeah.
But it's not always easiest to explain that to constituents who are unhappy they didn't get their stop sign.
Yes, no, and that's, it sounds like you guys have your hands full, but that's good to know that people can call and still
Absolutely,
make requests
call.
And make it known to their city councilmen and women.
Well, I can give you one example.
Yes.
Don't want to take up too much time on this, but a fella called complaining about traffic in his neighborhood, mm-hmm. just a few days ago. We talked to a police commander. So they did. They went out for 2 days, 2 hours a day, 21 violations, moving violations, in 4 hours. I mean, that's kind of unheard of.
Oh, my goodness.
The constituent was right. There was a traffic problem in his neighborhood, and it is now on the regular patrols. You know, they're going to monitor that as a hot spot. So glad that he called. You know, he sent this really nice thank you. And I told the police, this is really a thank you for you. So
yes.
I just read it to him over the phone. But, you know, they didn't necessarily have to respond to our request. But I think they were really glad they did, because they found out that person was really right. And of course, the person was happy. They got listened to.
Yes.
And that's the way the system should work.
Yes, wonderful. Well, I do want to go ahead and jump in. You mentioned that our city budget here is
$1.2 billion
a year. So tell me a little bit about the city budget for this next year coming up.
Well, they're going to raise taxes to pay for higher salaries and some new programs. I'm not saying the new programs aren't meritorious. I'm not saying all of us wouldn't like to give employees pay raises, but you're raising property taxes to do it. The city has raised the sales tax last August. The city raised the water bill, about $37 million earlier this year. They raised the fees to go to the airport, about $10 million raised there. And then now we're talking about the vote will be July 1st. You know, it's another I think $37 million in property tax increases on July 1st. So that's four big taxes that were raised just in the last 9 or 10 months. In addition, parking rates and everything to balance the budget a couple years ago, they, and I say they because I didn't vote for it, but the city council majority thought this was a good idea. They raised the parking rates downtown. When you think about everything you buy, mm-hmm. parking, water, and property, what else is there? So everybody's saying it's great, we got a balanced budget. Well, it's only balanced because you keep dramatically raising taxes. The money is going to pay raises and new programs. You know, that's a high price to pay. So I voted no on the budget. It just seems like it's going up and up and up. Part of the cost pressures the city faces is because of the pension issue, which I think people have seen in the paper quite a bit. Whatever you think of the pension system, it wasn't designed for people retiring at age 50 to get, in a lot of cases, not every case, certainly not the majority of cases, but in a lot of cases, six-figure pensions for 50 years.
Yes.
Insurance actuaries will tell you, you know, if you have a married couple that's 65, one of those people is going to 100. And so that was just not the way the system was set up. Obviously, the stock market dip a few years ago hurt us. And so there have been changes. The city has made changes. Things are better than they were. But all it's done really is slow down the rate of growth. And so we're still in a bad situation. We're spending tens of millions of dollars more every year, year over year, on pensions than we are on programs, parks, or current police officers and current firefighters, the things that people expect from the city.
It is escalating
dramatically.
What is our current sales tax here in the city of Phoenix?
So overall, I think you're paying roughly about 10%.
Goodness.
Yeah,
that's
so
a
it's high. I think when the state, and it's been a few years now, and I haven't looked at it recently, I think when the state added the sales tax to pay for the temporary one, the 3-year one to pay for schools, and again, I'm not saying that isn't meritorious, I think we're up there by Chicago and Cook County is the highest sales tax in the country. That's not really where you want to be. Now, that tax went away, so it's gone down. But I've heard a lot of stories about people. I was just talking to a friend this weekend who was talking about going, of all places, to California to get a car. I've heard about people going up to Canada. I know another councilman has because he mentioned it to me. People going to Canada to get a car because the taxes
aren't as high.
Wow. Now, I haven't verified either of those stories, but just the fact that they're being talked about, the fact that people would even consider going to Canada or California to get a car, if that's even something that entered your brain, you wouldn't think of that, but it's definitely something that is, I would say, problematic.
What is some of our biggest expenditures here in the city of Phoenix? What are some of
the biggest line items? A lot of it's public safety, and a lot of it is also people. You know, about 70% of our budget is people, and about 70-75% of our budget, roughly, is police and fire. So again, things that people would certainly miss if we didn't have them. Obviously, the pension costs going up dramatically is for past service, and courts have said, you know, you can't really change those deals, but going forward, we couldn't stick with the current system. It just was not sustainable, and I don't think anybody, hopefully none of your viewers at home, would say, I aspire to be just like Detroit or some of these other cities, Philadelphia, these cities with just terrible bond ratings where they can't even make their payments. Yes, maybe some of them will rally, but boy, they made it a lot harder on themselves than they needed to. So we're hopefully gonna do better. There have been changes to the city pension system, so it's really a two-tier system. We have about 30-35% of our employees are not police and firefighters. So those folks are in one system called the COPRS system, you know, the City of Phoenix Retirement. And we made some changes. We sent them to voters. Voters made changes. It wasn't as much as I thought it should be. And some of that, there was a subsequent change that gave some of that money back, which I thought was rather short-sighted last year. But regardless, at least it's bringing down the rate of increase. So at least things have slowed and really almost come to a stop, and now we're at the plateau on our costs. Okay, that's a good thing because the trajectory was straight uphill before. Police and fire are in a different system. It's a statewide system.
Okay.
And that's why voters recently in May passed, I think it was Prop 124. Firefighters and to a certain extent the police officers also went to the legislature and asked to actually have the pension system modified and really reduced. Not dramatically, but definitely reduced. Simply because I think they realized there's not going to be a pension system the way we're going. Yeah. If it all implodes, that's not good for our members. That's not good for the state. So I applaud.
What a logical way to approach
that. Well, it was a former city councilman named Brian Jeffries, who is the head of the firefighter union, who really led the charge on that. And I applaud him for his efforts because it was necessary. And so voters, obviously, they passed it, I think, 70-30 or something. So anytime something's getting 70% of the vote in this political climate, there's a lot of agreement. So people, I think, realized this is a big deal. And
we want to take care of them, but we need to also be reasonable.
Yes. Yeah, because at some point, we're going to have to cut everything else. And that's not acceptable to voters.
Yes. No, and that's...
Or to me.
No, no, and it's absolutely... Because like you said, it's kind of like a lot of government programs is if we don't trim around it, then eventually there won't be anything left, right? Yes. So that's a very reasonable approach, especially for our firefighters to take. That's a...
Good news is the city has been proactive. We're... Thanks to Bill Gates, a councilman who just left the council. He's running for county supervisor. He had worked very hard on efficiency savings. So we count as efficiency savings. We're providing the same service to constituents, but we're spending a lot less money to do it, you know, using computers and technology and trying to be more efficient. So the city is down about 3,000 employees from where it was at the peak. The peak was about 17,500 employees. But the pension costs and healthcare costs have gone up so much that we're not saving as much as that would imply, right? That implies you're saving like 1/6 of your costs. Costs us, I think, on average, for the average city employee, $108,000 to put the average city employee out in the street. And that's not all salary. Wow. That's healthcare, pension, and everything.
But that's
certainly a big number. That's a bottom
line
per person. Fire and police are much more expensive. You got to have a special school to train them. They've generally got more educational attainment. Obviously, the jobs are dangerous. You know, there's some fitness requirements. You know, so there are a lot of things that we look at. They're not the average employee, but there are a lot of the employees. And so that tends to skew that number a little bit. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is we have to pay what we have to pay.
Yes.
And it's $108,000.
For person.
And I forget, it's going to go up next year.
It is. With cost of living, everything goes up. Well, Councilman Waring, this is a topic that we could continue to discuss.
Sure.
Thank you so much for the information that you shared. You actually just mentioned a councilman that's going to be retiring, and we're actually going to be speaking about that next. So for all of you watching at home, please don't go anywhere. If you have any questions, the information's been displayed at the bottom of the screen. Again, if you have questions, complaints, or even compliments, I'm sure that the councilman's office would love
insults
to hear them.
Insults are more likely,
insults,
so I'd appreciate
that. But if
there's
that, compliments, everyone likes to hear something nice or a thank you every once in a while. So please don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after this short message.
Do you know the ABCs when it comes to putting your baby to sleep? A, baby should sleep alone. B, baby should sleep on their back. C, baby should always sleep in a crib. Also, keep bedding away from baby's face. Make sure not to overdress baby. And use a new mattress that fits tightly into the crib. For more tips on keeping babies safe when sleeping, go to safesleepaz.org.
I'm your host, Vanessa Rose. Thank you so much for staying with us. If you're just joining us today, we are joined by Councilman Jim Waring, and he is one of our City of Phoenix council members from District 2. Thank you so much for staying with us.
Thanks, Vanessa. I appreciate you having me back.
Yes, again. Yes. Wonderful to have you here. Great information. We were just speaking about the City of Phoenix budget. I know that I just learned some things that I wasn't aware of, and I think that sometimes living here in our city where people, we all have our own lives, people have different careers, sometimes you don't realize all that's actually going on behind the scenes. It's making the police there and the buses and the trails and all these things happening
that come
together.
We are council people, not presidents. We are aware that not everybody knows who their council person is or what they do or what's the difference between a council person, a county supervisor, and a state senator. I understand that's a muddle. It would be for me, too, if I wasn't in it. So I appreciate the fact that people pay attention to shows like this and try to become educated.
Yes. No, it's very important, especially as every year we have different elections for different offices, to know who they are. And I know that you've probably seen Jim's name on a sign somewhere. And the next gentleman that we're speaking about, actually District 3 councilperson, there's going to be an appointment. Mm-hmm. I know that everyone has seen his name because he has a very, very recognizable name, Bill Gates. And that's something that whenever you see that, it's kind of like, oh, I didn't know Bill Gates lived in Arizona. Well, it's not that Bill Gates.
I have professional envy of Bill. Yes. So there is a Waring blender, Fred Waring, the band leader. So I don't have But those namesakes of mine do not have quite the same impact. Name recognition as the Gates name.
And psychologically, we know that whole, you know, name recognition thing and all that. So that's a very wonderful thing to have if you're running for public office. But he is leaving to run for another office. So we're going to speak about the appointment and what that means to the city and kind of how that process works.
Well, I do have a new councilwoman. The appointment process has already taken its course. And her name is Deborah Stark. She is a former City of Phoenix planning department director, so she has a lot of experience with the city. I think she has about 30 years of experience both with the city, and then she was working with the county before this appointment. And she'll be a fine addition to the council, but I take some issue with the process that led to her appointment. It's not her fault, but it is a little bit frustrating at a time where, as we spoke in the first segment of the show, you know, we're talking about tax increases. There's a tax increase vote on July 1st. The people in District 3, because of the way this appointment process isn't handled, because it's the council that makes the decision, which is not the way the legislature handles things when there's an appointment there. Citizens do get to weigh in, some citizens anyway, from the district involved. In this, there isn't one person in District 3 who gets to vote on the appointment. And I just think that's wrong, given that we've got this huge tax vote coming up on July 1st. It really is taxation potentially without participation. I don't know how she's going to vote, but either way, she's weighing in on behalf of citizens who probably have never heard of her.
Yeah.
I mean, family and friends, but apart from that, you know, she hasn't run for office. They didn't get any say in her selection. It's a system that I think needs to be changed.
So how do these names even get put forward?
You apply just like a job. So you apply to the city council through the city clerk's office, just like a job. We're given the resumes and answers to some questions. We didn't get to question
the applicants.
Them? Nope.
We did not get to. That seems like a pretty important job that you should get an interview.
We got to ask one question, same question of each person.
Okay.
I might ask different questions of different people, but we got to submit one question, and they responded in writing to each of us. So there were nine total questions. You know, that's not really the same. I like to ask questions.
Yes.
As you can probably tell by having me on the show, I like to talk. And
I would have liked to have bantered with them
a little bit. Nine people, I believe it was, applied, and Deborah was chosen. It was quite, you know, I think, contentious kind of behind the scenes. The one fellow I mentioned who's running, Chris DeRose, he did not apply. I went through the same process when I ran for office. I defeated someone who was appointed. I also did not apply because I knew he was going to get the appointment and I wasn't, so I figured I'd rather go knock on doors and campaign and meet voters in the district than let people who don't live in the district, you know, pick the representative. Why even participate in that process? It's a little bit frustrating. If I was a voter in District 3, obviously I live in my own district, District 2, I don't know what I'd make of that. I mean, who's voting on my behalf? How did this happen? For Congress, I believe if there's a retirement or sadly, someone passes away, I believe it's 120 days they have to call a new election. I just think there could be a better process. I will tell you, when I was in the legislature, a corporation commissioner resigned, and he was a Republican, and Governor Napolitano was governor. She was a Democrat. But she, by state law, had to appoint a Republican.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, maybe that's not as conservative a Republican as some of us would like and so forth. But she had to pick someone who was a registered Republican.
You're still using what the voters chose.
You're not. I would argue our process, where you have Bill Gates, a conservative Republican, elected last year overwhelmingly. I can't even remember if he had an opponent, but he got either 100% of the vote or probably
close
80
to
or
it,
90.
Yeah.
You know, people clearly, nobody ran against him. People clearly made a decision. This is a heavily Republican district. And I'm not saying a Democrat can't win it. I'm not saying only a Republican can represent it.
But the voters spoke to what they wanted and the principles.
And now
they
we're having these big votes, and Bill is gone, and he was replaced with a Democrat. And that is a change. The reason these labels get applied is because they do mean something as a filter to voters. And I just think that would be surprising to a lot of voters in that district. Wait a minute, how did this happen? Because as you suggested before, people aren't fixated on this. They're not watching, nor should they be.
No.
You know, every second of every day. But if their property taxes go up, if that's a deciding vote, and I'm not saying it is, I don't know how that's going to go. She may vote against it. But boy, that wouldn't sit very well with me.
Yes.
And so I've expressed that to the newspaper and other media outlets, and I'm glad you're giving me a chance to talk about it on the show.
No, because you're essentially saying that what the voters chose is not what you're going
they're getting
to
the
continue.
Opposite is getting, what they're, I mean, you know, I don't know if she'll vote the opposite on every vote.
So it's kind of one of those things where regardless of which side you're on, it's the same. If it were someone of the other party in there, then this same party
should be
appointed.
I think that would be strange as well.
Yeah.
I mean, it's equal on both sides. I'm surprised this has been the process. and that nobody has really subjected this to scrutiny before.
Why does the city of Phoenix do it that way? Because I know, let's say, here we're in the middle of a big presidential race. Mm-hmm. People that were running for the office of the President of the United States didn't have to resign from their political mm-hmm. positions. How come within the city of Phoenix you have to resign before an actual election?
Well, that's a state law. That was passed in, I believe, 1992.
That's the whole state of Arizona.
Yes, whole state of Arizona.
Okay.
You're right about the people in other states. Barack Obama was a state senator who ran for Congress, lost, but was still a state senator afterwards,
state senator.
And then ran for the
U.S.
Senate. So
that's statewide
Yes,
law.
So it's state,
okay.
not federal. But the state, the voters have spoken. That's what they wanted. But these appointments make a big difference. So you and I were talking before the show. Greg Stanton, the current mayor, was an appointee. He replaced Sal DiCicco. Sal DiCicco resigned his office in 2000. He's back in the council now, but he resigned in 2000. He was a Republican. He was replaced by Greg Stanton, a Democrat. Now, Greg's an adept politician. Maybe he would have been able to win the office on his own. We'll never know. He got appointed, served for 9 years, was out for 2 years. But then he ran for mayor, and so he's leaving office in January of 2020.
Wow.
So 20 years later, voters are still, and again, I don't mean this negatively
yes.
towards him. I disagree with a lot of his positions, but voters are still being impacted, affected, whatever word you want to use that doesn't have a negative connotation, by Greg Stanton.
Yes.
But I don't know that there was one person. I'd have to look at who lived where, because if the mayor lived, I don't think the mayor did live in Greg's district back then. So not one person in the mayor's district back then participated in selecting him for that spot in the first place. And here
wow.
we are 20 years later. That certainly, it didn't make him mayor, but it certainly gave him a big leg up. And again, this isn't to diminish his
yes.
skills or anything else. It's just a fact that this could have a 20-year impact. We have 12-year term limits for council people. But she gets to finish Bill's term. Deborah Stark, I mean, gets to finish Bill Gates' term, which is about 3.5 years to run. So she could be a council person for 15 and a half years
so
because that partial term doesn't count.
That's kind of like the governor whenever they were appointed.
The governor, it does count. The
it
partial
does
term
count.
Counts.
How interesting.
But
so
the city, it does
doesn't.
Not. I was surprised to learn that, too.
That's interesting.
She could be there for 15 and a half years. She could become mayor at some point. It could happen. It just seems strange that not one voter in her district participated in this original process.
And that doesn't count towards the full term limits.
Also
well,
a little odd.
Councilman Waring, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. This has been a wonderfully informative session and an ability for you at home to learn a little bit more about what's going on in the city. Thank you so much for joining
us. I hope at least two viewers enjoyed it.
Yes.
I don't know, but I appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
It.
And thank you. We will see you next time on Joy in Our Town.
This program has been sponsored by the Trinity Broadcasting Network and is made possible by your telephone dollars. Your continual support can keep Joy in Our Town coming to your home every week. Write to Joy in Our Town, Post Office Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711.